girls from a mighty little way. That's why we love this guy.
These are organizations that contribute to scholarship, uplifting their community, community service, and just striving all the way around to make things positive and better than the way that it was passed down, which is exactly what we've all wanted. Every parent wants to make things better for their children, for every generation. And I'm proud to be a member of Zeta Phi Beta Sorority Incorporated. And at this time, I just want to kind of give a shout out to every organization that is represented here. Can I please ask all members of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated to please stand? Alpha Phi Alpha is the first black fraternity that was founded in December of 1906 at Cornell University. So if you can just imagine, at Cornell, an Ivy League school, in 1906, you had members, I believe it was seven. Was it seven of y'all?
Seven.
Seven.
Seven, you're right.
It was seven Jules, was that right? Seven Jules that had to organize to support each other and get through and get by. And look at what that organization has done today, the first that has celebrated 100 years in existence. Next, I'm going to announce the first black sorority, which is Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, January 1908. Do we have any AKAs in the house? Please stand. AKAs were the first sorority to be founded, and they were the first black sorority to be founded, and the first black sorority to be founded on a historically black college university campus, Howard University. Then comes along 1911. 1911, we had two fraternities that were founded in the same year. In January 1911, we had the men of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated. If they could please stand. Kappa Alpha Psi was founded on the campus of Indiana University in Indiana. Also in the year 1911, we had the brothers of Omega Psi Phi. Omega Psi Phi is November 1911. Do we have any Qs in the house? one of the things that we wanted to talk about was not only prominent members of Black history, but prominent members of Black history who were also a part of Black fraternities and sororities. And this is so important because so many people think that fraternities and sororities end when you leave college. And I would challenge anyone who is in to know that the real work starts after you join. And it's never ending. We are here to commemorate Black History Month, which morphed out of Black History Week, or Negro History Week as it was called back then, from a gentleman, Carter G. Woodson, who was a member of Omega Psi Phi. The next sorority we had was Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, and they were also founded on Howard University's campus in Washington, D.C., and that was in 1913. If I can ask all ladies of DST to please take the stage. The next fraternity was My Brothers in Blue of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated. Blue Phi in the house! Colors for Phi Beta Sigma. For those of you who don't know, Phi Beta Sigma and my sorority, Zeta Phi Beta, are the only sorority and fraternity that by constitution are bound as sister and brother. And I am very proud of that. And they were founded also at Howard University in January 1914. And so next is the esteemed ladies of Zeta Phi Beta Sorority Incorporated. Can I please ask all ladies to please stand? Of Howard University in the year of January 1920. After that, we had the esteemed ladies of Sigma Gamma Rho, which was founded in Butler University in Indiana, and that was in the year of 1922. Do I have any Gamma Rhos that are in the house? Please stand. We had a new member to join the National Pan-Hellenic Council, and we are so thrilled that you are now a part of the body, and that is the Brothers of Iota Phi Theta, who were found at another historically Black college and university, which is Morgan State. I'm gonna ask all my Morgan people over there, you know, Shelly. At Morgan State University in Baltimore, Maryland, and that was founded in 1963, and this year is their 50th anniversary. I wanted to do that because it is so important to me that people recognize that we are educators, we are homeowners, we are business people, we are in every field that you can imagine, engineers, and all types of things that are just making and shaping this great country of ours, especially this dynamic county that we have here in Nassau County. 1.3 million people live right here in Nassau County, and you organizations are making an impact on this great county every day. Please give yourselves a round of applause. Another person who is having a dynamic impact, it just goes without words, my heart goes out to her. Her name is Miss Joycetta Pierce. Miss Joycetta Pierce is the co-founder of the African Atlantic Genealogical Society. And this is so important because we have to know our history. We have to recognize our history in order to know how to move forward. We're constantly being told that the world is changing, our demographics are evolving, but we have to know where we come from so that we can begin to strengthen and build upon those very strong foundations that were laid for us. I've been told that Ms. Pierce is also a member of Mensa's, which is a prestigious organization, and she is also basically the keeper as to why the Nassau County African American Museum, her and her husband in partnership, Mr. Julius Pierce, who's here as well, they are the reason that we are able to still enjoy some of the acts in this space and to be able to gather in such a beautiful museum. So,
but we were asked to help out by managing programs and the museum. It was daunting at first, but we thank you so much because you know what? This county could have said, you know, things are a little tight. We may have to close that building and all our own museums and things. But they didn't say that. They said there has to be a way for us to sustain these museums and keep them open. Because you know, whenever there are deficits or management problems or you know, just don't have enough money, what goes first is always the arts, unfortunately. And the museum is a place for the arts and history and culture and tradition. And we are so happy that Mr. McGannell and his administration have made a way for those doors to stay open. They're there to repair anything that goes wrong. The only thing they don't handle are the programs, and that's what we handle for them. And we just are so happy to do it. It's a work of love. We don't think it's a courageous thing to do. It's just the right thing to do for this time. And I know we're going to talk about excellence in education and history, but I wanted you to understand just what that institution is. It was started at Nassau Community College by then Professor Leroy Leonardo Ramsey. He was just a professor there, and it was Black History Month, and it was 1968. And he wanted to show his own collection of things that he had come across that were historical. And he asked for permission for a little space at the end of a corridor at the school where he could set up, and he did. It was a wonderful thing. The students were so happy because there was nothing else representing their culture on the campus. So at the end of that Black History Month, they said, well, it's going to come down now. We're going to take the exhibit down. And there was so much of an uproar that they pressed the president and asked him, could we please leave it in place? And it stayed in place for a couple of years. Mr. Ramsey then moved into a storefront on Main Street. And at that time, it stood there a few years, 2 years. And then Nassau County happened to have purchased the building at 110 North Franklin Street. And between Mel Jackson, who was very concerned about the museum, and the then deputy county exec, Russell Service, worked together to say, can't we bring this museum into a better place rather than just a storefront? And Mel insisted that this had to be moved to a better place because it was more than just Professor Ramsey. It was an institution. Mel advised him that you're an individual, things change, people's tastes change, the world changes. You don't want to lose this space after a while when you're no longer able to handle it. It becomes an institution and it moves into a county facility, it will have longevity. And that's exactly what happened. It still existed because the county supported it along with its other museums. And we have to be very thankful for that, and we have to continue and to support it and to make sure that it continues to go on and be an institution that represents our culture. Right now it's a show museum, and it shows you your history. That's what we're there to do. We're not a collecting museum. We don't have a lot of money to buy artifacts, so we don't have artifacts. We show you your raw data. Who you are is the primary purpose there. You learn your own history through your genealogy. You find out there are heroes in your family because the mere fact that you are here means that somebody suffered unbearably for you to exist. And even if your family was a free family, some people are so proud that their family was free when they got here. They came here from another country. They came here during slavery time on their own and were wealthy and they lived well and they were free, but they still suffered because of their color. So if they could have survived all of that, you do your family history and you'll find that one person who set the mark for you. And that's why we teach young children very early on. And thank God in Nassau County, every fourth grade student has to prepare a family tree. They have to do some work on their family. And I think that's a marvelous thing. Our regent, Adelaide Sanford, she was very much responsible for bringing that forward and making it possible for the schools to incorporate that. But the genealogy gives them roots. It lets them have solid ground on which to stand. And we focus at the museum. We say that we are the African American Museum of Nassau County, and we cover all of Long Island. Our focus is Nassau County, but we cover everything from Brooklyn all the way out to Montauk. Any African American history that's available. We don't think many people know about Pierce Consor. You know that Admiral Perry was the first one to roll into Japan, and when Japan had closed its borders to the world and had decades of history going on in their country without any contact with the Western world. And everybody thinks that Admiral Perry was the first one to get there. But Pierce Consor was there 7 years before Perry got there. Pierce Consor was working on a ship. He was a whaler. He was the best whaler in his country. He was from Southampton, that's where he was born. And he was born in a free person. His father had been a slave, but his father had been freed. And he grew up as a young man in the house of Mercator Cooper, and he started working with him as a whaler. He was so expert at dealing with the piloting of this whaling ship that when they put a harp into a whale, the whale would flail around and turn the ship over, and all kinds of things would happen. But he was astute enough to ride with the whale, and he would keep the boat in tune with the whale, and it would not turn the ship over, and he was beloved everywhere. And on a whaling trip to Japan, they came across some Japanese soldiers, whalers, who had lost their ship. It was, shipwrecked, and they were there, and they couldn't get any help, and they saved them, they brought them on this ship, and they returned them to the port at Japan. And the Japanese Army Navy came out and they said, no, you can't come in here. He said, well, look, we've got a couple of your people on this ship. We saved them. They were dying, we saved them. They said, oh, okay, then we'll, very skeptical, but they did say, okay, well, you can come into our port. And then they saw Pierce Consor. And Pierce Consor was a very, very dark-complexioned man. And they hadn't seen anyone like him. And they were really impressed with him. And of course, he was a religious man. He knew a few tunes, and he sang, and they drank sake together. And they were so impressed with him, they wanted to, touch him and see if the color came off or anything, And there are even pictures, that paintings that were made during that time, showing Pierce Consor, his brother-in-law was with him, and all of the men of the ship and the Japanese all sat together drinking sake at this little party. So they did leave. They couldn't stay much longer, and they went on their way. And the port closed again. But when they heard that this ship was coming in, this is 7 years later, and here comes Admiral Perry, they said, oh, Americans are coming back. We're probably going to see some of those guys again, like y'all friend Pierce. But of course, they rolled in. There was no black guys on that ship. So they didn't have much, they didn't have much soul singing on that trip. But Perry made other arrangements, and he made some treaties, and he made it possible for us to go to Japan. And the Pierce Consor story is important to us because we are on a new track right now. We're on a thing called Go Figure, F-I-G-A-H. We're filling in the gaps of African American history because there are so many stories that we don't know that are empowering. They set examples for us, and that's the kind of history we're bringing forward. We want people to know about Pierce Consor, that he's buried right here in Southampton. We want